show, and I've adjusted it and brought some other Oregon issues into it. And so I'm really excited to get to give you that that show tonight. Can we bring the lights down in here some so that everybody, is it possible to bring them down, or is that not, I don't know if it's not a big deal. But that's a little bit too much. But as Rand said, I was trained by former Vice President Al Gore in Nashville, Tennessee in 2006. I was one of the first 50 people to get trained by Al Gore in giving his slideshow and in giving him truth. And since that time, I've traveled all over, particularly Oregon, giving the show. Currently, I am one of two members from Oregon, representing Oregon on the Northwest Power and Conservation Council, which includes, the council includes the states of Oregon, Washington, Idaho, and Montana. And basically what the Power Council does is we develop a 20-year plan for electricity in this region and making sure we have enough electricity in this region. We also work very hard to protect and restore fish and wildlife that have been affected by the construction of all the dams on the Columbia River. And throughout all of that, we work to involve the public in both our energy and our fish and wildlife work. And one of our biggest challenges is that we have almost fully developed the Columbia River for hydro. There's not a whole lot more hydro potential on the Columbia River, and the salmon are already suffering from what we've already done, so it's unlikely we're going to develop much more hydro on the Columbia River. But even with that wonderful hydro system, we still get 40%, almost 40% of our electricity from burning coal and other fossil fuels. And as I think everybody in this room knows, basically, when you burn coal, you increase carbon pollution. And all that carbon is having quite an impact on the world as we know it. Now, somewhere there may be a planet, there may be an Earth where the temperature is not getting hotter. Somewhere there may be an Earth where the temperature is not getting hotter, but it's pretty clear that it's not here. And this is a picture from India in May of 2015. 2,300 people died in the heat wave in India in 2015. This was in Pakistan nearby in June of 2015. This is the morgue from the over 1,200 people that died from the heat in Pakistan. Now, there might be an Earth somewhere where the heat index isn't going up like it is in Iran, where it reached 165 degrees. 165 degrees was the heat in Iran in July of 2015. And not just Iran, Germany broke its all-time heat record, reaching almost 105 degrees in one town in Germany. If you look at the map of Europe during the heat wave in 2015, it's pretty remarkable. Goes to places like London, England, were 98 degrees. Places like Madrid, Spain, were 104 degrees. Cordoba, Spain, 110 degrees. In the Netherlands, it was 100 degrees. So they had just an incredible heat wave in late June and early July of this year. We've had similar situations in this country. This is in Los Angeles in 2010. It was 121 degrees Fahrenheit one day. One sunny afternoon in Los Angeles. Now, there may be an Earth somewhere where deeper and longer droughts are not killing crops, animals, and people, but that certainly is not the case in Sao Paulo, Brazil, where this normally would be looking at water, but it's an empty reservoir. And 140 cities in Brazil rationed water last year. And basically about a fifth of Brazil's population is being affected by the drought, was affected by the drought in 2015. And this is Santo Domingo in the Dominican Republic, where people are getting water that's provided to them by the government because it's the worst drought they've had there in years. And this is this is in South Korea. And basically you have a drought there that's affecting crops and water supplies in both North and South Korea. And this is in India in 2015. And India has suffered through back-to-back drought years recently that have just been really phenomenal. I think we all have seen about what's going on in California. Basically, they had a really record drought in 2015 and 2014 and 2013. 97% of the Golden State is in drought. And 45% of it is in what's called exceptional drought. And let's just see what that means. This is a picture of Folsom Lake in Northern California. It was taken in July of 2011. And this is what Folsom Lake looked like in January of 2014. So pretty remarkable difference. 2011, that's what the reservoir looked like in 2014. Snow in the Sierras, not happening. Snowpack in California, Sierra Nevada mountains reached an estimated 500-year low in 2015. Same thing, you know, we talk a lot about all the civil problems in Syria, but there's a fundamental other thing going on in Syria, which is people can't survive there anymore. This is a Syrian farmer. It had 400 acres of wheat, and now that 400 acres of wheat is all desert. If you look at the period from 2006 to 2010, drought turned 60% of Syria's fertile land into desert, and by 2010, the drought had killed 80% of the country's cattle. So you might understand why they're having so much difficulty governing that country. It's not, certainly not the only reason, but it would be a big contribution to that. And it's pretty amazing. Climate change has now been recognized as a real threat by the U.S. Department of Defense. Climate change will likely lead to food and water shortages, pandemic disease, disputes over refugees and resources, and destruction by natural disasters in regions all across the globe. That's the Department of Defense saying that in 2014. And lo and behold, here we are this year. These are Syrian refugees trying to get on a train in Croatia. Lo and behold, exactly what the Department of Defense said would happen has been happening. The Syrian refugee crisis is really the beginnings of the future. It's not going to go away. The numbers we now have of refugees fleeing battle zones are going to be diminished into almost nothing when we see the mass movement of populations caused by global warming. And that's a quote from Lord Ashdown in Britain. Example of that is what we see happening in Senegal. Serious drought problems. Now, there may be an earth where the fires are not spreading widely and burning hotter and longer, but that certainly wasn't true in California this last summer. This is some examples of the fires in California. Destroyed over 2,000 homes in September and left a lot of people really trying to deal with their incredible loss. And this was another fire in Middletown. Kind of a sad picture. This is where I belong, or I guess it's where I used to belong. Same kind of pictures we saw before in earlier this fall in California. This is in Valparaiso, Chile. So that citizen was just looking out over Valparaiso, and this is what he got to see the next morning. The whole city basically went up in smoke, and it left a lot of people sort of wondering what they're going to do with themselves. Same thing happened in South Australia in January of last year, 2015. And there was an incredible fire that many people may remember in 2010 in Russia. This is what the Kremlin looked like in 2010. And 55,000 people in Russia died because of those incredible fires in 2010. And people just were left fleeing the fire and being very, very upset. So there may be an Earth where the winds and the storms are not getting more destructive, but that certainly wasn't true in New Jersey in 2012, or in Texas in 2008, or in China in 2006. Wind had a devastating effect in all those places. And there may be a place where the rainstorms are not getting any bigger, but that certainly wasn't true in Montana in 2010. And it certainly wasn't true in Florida earlier last year.
Somebody in here! Please, there's someone in here! Oh my God!
And there might be a planet somewhere where bigger floods are not wreaking havoc like they did on the Mississippi River or Utah. 21 people died from flash flooding earlier this year.
Oh no, they don't sound sick. Oh my goodness, coming in our
Houston, Texas in late May of last year of 2015. Incredible flash flood that caught everybody by surprise. Same thing's going on in other parts of the world. This is sort of the aftermath of a flash flood in Chile. And this is an incredible picture from Georgia in Europe, where 19 people and 19 people were killed by the rainstorm, and more than half of the zoo's 600 animals were killed by the rainstorm. I wouldn't be wanting to be walking with that rhinoceros. It's not something I would really like to enjoy. But then it's also, there was the same thing happened. This is in India in June of 2013. And you know that incredible statue has been there peacefully overseeing the situation in India for many, many, many years. and now it's swamped with flood water. Same thing true in North Korea. This was in 2012, and Australia in 2011, and in the Philippines in 2008, and India in 2000, Philippines was 2009, India 2008. Now, the reality is we are seeing just significant climate impacts all over the planet. And that gives you sort of some feel for some of those climate impacts. And it's very interesting because one of the largest reinsurance companies in the world has dropped any pretense of denying anything and says that the only plausible explanation for the rise of weather-related catastrophes is climate change. This is one of the largest reinsurance companies in the world.
This is no longer something that's theory or conjecture or something that comes out of computer models. We are observing the climate change. It's happening. It's real. It's a scientific fact.
I hope you could hear that. I could hear it barely, but basically this is a scientist saying that climate change is real. It's happening. It's a scientific fact. So let me just show you some things that have changed in the recent past. This is a chart that shows the rise in the carbon emissions all over the planet from the burning of fossil fuels. And you can see that the chart really starts to take off in about the 1950s and just skyrockets up by the current time. As CO2 increases, so does the temperature. This is a chart on the left, is the increase in carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. It's a rather dramatic spike. And you can see on the right what has happened to the temperature. There are a lot of variations year to year, but the trend is really clear. The carbon dioxide is going up, and the temperature is going up as well. And, you know, we know where it comes from. We know where greenhouse gases come from. They come from traffic, they come from factories, they come from mining activities, and they come from industrial agriculture. All of those are sources of this increased greenhouse gas. And this is a chart that just shows Oregon's 2010 greenhouse gas emissions. The biggest source in Oregon, because we get so much electricity from hydro, the biggest source in Oregon is, in fact, from transportation, cars and trucks, 36%. Electricity, we still have a lot of electricity, even though we have a lot of hydro, we have a lot of electricity that comes from coal. That's where 23% of our greenhouse gases in Oregon come from. 20% come from industry, and about 9% come from agriculture. And those are the largest sources of greenhouse gases in this state. And something happened that was really amazing a couple of years ago. In 2013, the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere hit a new record, which is 400 parts per million. So CO2 has generally been a lot lower than that in the past, but it started to get closer and closer and closer, and we hit the 400 parts per million in May of 2013. And guess what? It's changing the global average temperature. This is a chart that shows global average temperature. And you can see by the time CO2 was hitting 400 parts per million, temperature was going up, up, up. Not surprisingly, as temperature increases, the oceans evaporate more and more moisture into the skies. So it's loading the skies up with more and more moisture. And what happens with that moisture? Well, guess what? It comes down as rain. This is a chart that shows the increase in heavy precipitation days. And you can see very clearly as we move into 2000 and 2010, you have more and more heavy rain.
One of the changes we've seen is that the average humidity of our planet has increased by 4%. Warmer air holds more water vapor. And so on average, our atmosphere is 4% more humid than it used to be 30 or 40 years ago. So when storms come through, there's more water for them to pick up and dump.
Dump, 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 they do. And one of the best, saddest, worst examples of this supercharged storm system is Hurricane Sandy, which came ashore in end of October in 2012. And Hurricane Sandy was an incredibly devastating storm on the East Coast. It basically battered the East Coast, and tragically, at least 160 people lost their lives in total in that storm. And sadly, science tells us that this type of event will become much more common as our climate continues to change. And Governor Cuomo was looking at the taxi cabs in New York City flooded, and he said, "I think we all need to realize that climate change is a reality, extreme weather is a reality. It's a reality that we are vulnerable as that climate changes." Another incredible example of really, we've had a lot of typhoons in history. It's not like typhoons never happened before. We've had a lot of typhoons. But the fact is, the way the climate is changing, typhoons like Typhoon Haiyan, which took place in 2013, are really supercharged typhoons. And basically, 5,000 people were estimated to have been killed by Typhoon Haiyan. Hundreds of thousands of people were displaced by the storm, and really, scientists say the typhoon really was the most powerful to make landfall in history. Sustained winds of 147 miles per hour, gusts to 170 miles per hour, waves all stirred up by all this wind. Waves struck the shore of the Philippines. A wave normally were 45 feet high. So it was a truly devastating climate-driven storm. And 2 years later, Pope Francis came to the Philippines and delivered a service during another not-so-severe typhoon. And Pope Francis made it very clear that it's the poor that really, really suffered from climate change and from these extreme weather events. So let me shift our attention to here at home. Let me shift to the Northwest. I want to talk about some specific climate impacts that we're seeing here at home. Let's start with the mountain that we're very familiar with right out our door, Mount Hood. This is a picture of Mount Hood looking at the White River Glacier in 1902. And this is the picture of Mount Hood, same time of the year, looking at the White River Glacier in 2001. So there it was in 1902, there it is in 2001. So let's look at another picture of Mount Hood. This one was taken in 1901, looking at the Elliott Glacier on Mount Hood. And this is what the Elliott Glacier looked like in 2015. So you see this incredible August, both pictures taken in August. So there's 1901 and there's 2015. An incredible loss of glaciation and snowpack on our Cascade Peaks. In fact, if you look at this chart, it shows the reduction in snowpack on all on Mount Hood for all the glaciers. Biggest loss was White River Glacier at 61%. Smallest was 15% reduction of snowpack on Coe Glacier. But the point is, all of the glaciers on Mount Hood lost significant snowpack in the last 100 years. Same thing's true if you go a little bit north to Mount Adams. This is a look at glacier loss or loss between 1904 and 2006. The white is obviously the glaciers as they existed in 1904. The gray or gray color is the extent of the glaciers in 2006. You're seeing it on all the Cascade ranges, this loss of glaciation. This is a scientist, her name is Dr. Ann Nolan, and she's been studying how much water comes from the glaciers and the snowpack, and what's the impact of shrinking glaciers. And look at this map of Mount Hood, and you learn that almost 75% of the water in the middle fork of the Hood River comes from melting glaciers. That water obviously provides irrigation in the Hood River Valley, and the water supported about 14,000 acres of fruits and berries worth millions of dollars in 2002. But Dr. Nolan says, don't just think about water supplies for agriculture. Receding glaciers don't just threaten agriculture. She points to this map again, and she says, look at the area around the glaciers that's red. That's the area where the glacier has shrunk. And when the glacier shrinks, it exposes what's underneath the glacier. And what's underneath the glacier is a whole lot of rocks that the glacier travels on. And lo and behold, it was 2006, down the mountain came all that exposed glacial underlayment that was rocks that used to be under the glacier that came down the mountain, and it basically enables a large debris flow. And this is a picture of the White River, which comes down from the White River Glacier. And you can see very clearly that there's a big glacier, a big river valley there. It's actually gotten a lot bigger because all that glacial debris came down and scooped out the river valley. And you can see at the top of the picture further down the hill that Oregon Highway 35 crosses the White River. And this is the bridge, the White River Bridge, over the White River with Oregon 35. And basically in November of 2006, debris 30 feet deep was upstream of the White River Bridge on the White River. And this is, you can get the feeling of the force of the debris coming downstream by this picture. And basically, this is the White River Bridge again. And this is Highway 35, right near the White River Bridge. And basically, the movement of debris and water downstream basically took out the highway and gave a big job to the Oregon Department of Transportation to get it reopened. You also saw, this is where Hood River meets the Columbia River. The Columbia River is at the bottom of the picture, going left to right, going downstream, it's going to the right. And you can see a Hood River coming into the Columbia River, and oh boy, there's a new delta forming for the Hood River because of all the debris that came down from Mount Hood because of an incredible rainstorm instead of a snowstorm. It rained instead of snowed on Mount Hood and brought down a huge amount of debris as those glaciers exposed their underlayment to movement by water. I think all of us know that it's hotter at the equator and cooler at the poles, and we know that that temperature differential leads to significant ocean currents. We also know it leads to a lot of wind patterns all over the globe. And as the globe warms, you start to see an increase of average temperature about 1 degree at the pole, but you see an average increase of 12 degrees, 1 degree at the equator, and you now see an increase of about 12 degrees at the poles. And nobody can tell you what that's going to do or what that is doing to ocean currents and wind patterns all over the planet. Best example for us is what's called the ocean dead zone off the Central Oregon coast. You can see this map, it's right off Newport. And the ocean off the Central Oregon coast experienced its most severe dead zone in recorded history during the summer of 2006. Now the dead zone is dead because of extremely low oxygen in the water. It's too low to support plants or animals. This is Dr. Jane Lipchenko, who was the administrator of the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. She also is a professor at Oregon State University. And she and her colleagues now conclude that dead zones are directly related to climate change. Dead zones, the reason she says that is because dead zones are caused by changes in wind patterns. In other words, when you, a couple of years ago, the wind blew every day from the north, northwest. Every day it blew, and it basically caused, because of that constant change in wind patterns, that created the ocean dead zone. And those kinds of changes in wind patterns are very consistent with predictions of climate change. So let me show you a little video that OSU shot at the bottom of the ocean. The video was collected by a remote sub operated by OSU in the shallower 65-foot water near the shore. This is what it looked like off the coast of Oregon when the dead zone struck. And what you're looking at there is a whole lot of dead crabs and some dead fish that just couldn't find life support with water that provided enough oxygen, and then just died on the bottom. So when you see a map of the dead zone, think of the bottom of the ocean. That's what it looks like. I currently work particularly on the Columbia River on the Northwest Power and Conservation Council. I get really concerned because we're finding average temperatures, August, September, water temperatures in the main stem Columbia, somewhere between 68 and 71 degrees. How many people remember stories about sockeye salmon earlier this summer, June, dying, trying to get back to where they wanted to spawn? About half of the entire run of sockeye salmon died just trying to get back to their spawning grounds because the Columbia River was too high. Scientists project that as you go out 2020, 2040, the red areas are areas where it's considered too hot for salmon to survive. Essentially, by the time you get to 2040s, you're looking at the entire Snake River in Idaho being too hot for salmon. You're looking at the whole Yakima River in eastern Washington too hot for salmon. And you're looking at a lot of stretches of the Willamette River in Oregon too hot for salmon. So it's kind of like we go, wait a minute, this is supposed to be in the salmon capital. But salmon may have a harder and harder time surviving here. I'm going to show you this chart. It's a little complicated. I apologize for that. Don't really try to understand it. It's a chart that shows the Willamette River starts down, or you know, around the Mackenzie River down near Eugene, and then it goes up to Salem, and then it goes up to Portland and joins with the Columbia. And what you're looking at in that map, and this is from 2015, and this is the heat thermometer of the Willamette River. And basically, as you move north of Salem, essentially the Columbia River gets somewhere between 72 and 75 degrees. Well, I'm sorry, the Willamette, thank you, the Willamette River gets somewhere between 72 and 75 degrees. That's not healthy for salmon. Salmon will not live in that kind of water temperature. Basically, the result will be more and more dead fish lying by the side, unable to get back to where they're trying to spawn. I think we also know that there's a significant impact on snowpack. And this is looking at snowpack in the Northwest states, Oregon, Washington, Idaho, part of Montana, part of British Columbia, and Alberta. And you can see the historical snowpack on the left. You can see the projected snowpack in 2060. In the middle chart, the darker the red, the more you're going to see a change in the amount of snowpack. So this is a historical snowpack in the Cascades. And I point out at the southwestern part of the state in the Siskiyous, you see some real snowpack. That's historical. And then this is what the scientists expect by 2060. And first place I look is I live in Bandon, Oregon. So I look down there close to my home. And basically the snowpack has all but disappeared in the Siskiyous, and the snowpack has really diminished on the Cascades. And this is a comparison between the current historical snowpack in the Cascades in southwestern Oregon and the expected snowpack by 2060. And so what you're seeing is a significant reduction in snowpack. And basically snowpack is the best way we have to store water to make it through the dry summer months. So the more the snowpack declines, the less ability we're going to have to deal with the droughts in summer. Fish are already responding to this loss. We're seeing more and more fish die. And we're also seeing some big changes in other industries like the oyster industry. It's pretty amazing. If you go to Willapa Bay in Washington, Willapa Bay is really what I would call the epicenter of the West Coast multi-million dollar oyster industry. And they have relied for years and years and years on naturally spawning oysters, reproducing, and then they harvest them and sell them all over the world. And when oysters spawn, the larvae swim free, and then they attach to shells, and that's called an oyster seed. It's also known as a set. And basically, most oysters fail to reproduce in the wild in Willapa Bay ever since 2005. Basically, what had been a thriving industry all of a sudden turned into one where you couldn't find any additional oysters. Same thing happened in the Whiskey Creek Shellfish Hatchery on Oregon's coast. 80% of the oyster larvae died in the hatchery. 80% of them just died in the hatchery. People were going, they're really scratching their head, but what's going on here? Why can't we grow oysters? What's going on here? So let's just take a little analysis here. Right now, we're emitting about 6.3 billion metric tons of carbon into the atmosphere. I can't really imagine how much that is, but it's a lot. I know it's a lot. And about half of that carbon gets sequestered by the oceans, the soils, and the trees. So about half the carbon gets sequestered or absorbed, and the other half just builds up in the atmosphere. So what happens to carbon when it gets sequestered by the ocean? Carbon dioxide turns into carbonic acid in the ocean. And the absorption of carbon dioxide has led to a real increase in the acidity level in the ocean. And you can see right here, on the left side is what healthy oyster larvae look like. On the right side is what oyster larvae look like in acidic ocean, which is what we have off the coast of Oregon and Washington today. So basically, the ocean acidification that's taken place because of the huge buildup of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is killing baby oysters and forcing industries to basically relocate in places where that hasn't happened as much yet, like Goose Point oysters in Willapa Bay. They relocated to Hawaii. They now run a big shellfish hatchery in Hawaii. It's working, it's really great, producing lots and lots of oysters that they then can ship back to Willapa Bay as more developed oysters, and they can provide all the oyster lovers in the world with lots of good, good stuff. It's really left a real question mark, though, for the oyster growers that still exist in the Northwest are finding it more and more difficult to know what's going to happen, because they really have a very uncertain future because of ocean acidification. Taylor shellfish, Goose Point shellfish did great because they moved to Hawaii, but not everybody can move to Hawaii. Let's talk for a minute about some very specific climate impacts in various regions of Oregon. Let's start with the Rogue River. It's a river that my wife and I like to love to go do whitewater trips on as many times as possible we can in the year. And there was a collaborative study that was done on the effects of climate change on the Rogue Basin. It was done by the Climate Leadership Initiative at the University of Oregon and the U.S. Forest Service's Northwest Research Lab. And basically what they found is the study predicts that dry season temperatures will increase by 15 degrees before 2080, and as a result there'll be far less snowfall than in previous years. And the extended dry season means that snow will begin melting much earlier than in past years, and this means that more precipitation will fall as rain rather than snow over the next century. And that means that the transition from snow to rain and the faster, earlier snow melt will combine to create flashier spring and winter floods, which will pose a major flood hazard to the Rogue Basin. And at the same time, decreased snowfall and increased temperatures mean that in spite of flashier spring floods, Rogue Basin streams are likely to be much drier during the extended summer months. Dry streams, no big surprise here, dry streams in turn increase the threats posed by bacteria and disease from the water, which reduces the number of fish that are able to survive in Rogue Basin streams. So let's go to another region of California. It's an area where there's been some controversy about fish and water. It's the Klamath River Basin. In southern Oregon at the top of the chart, and northern California at the bottom part of the map. And basically in southern Oregon, it's mostly irrigated agriculture and wildlife refuges and with lakes. And the major treaty tribe in that area is the Klamath tribe. And basically scientists say that they expect a decrease in snowpack from somewhere between 73% and 90% by 2075, and that's going to create a dramatic reduction in water supply in the Klamath Basin. And how many people here remember the huge controversy over water supply in the Klamath Basin in 2002? I remember it very well because it was an incredibly troubling event. Where you basically had a real crisis between farmers and water supply and salmon. And there really was not enough water to meet the needs of farmers and to meet the needs of fish. And it led to people illegally opening irrigation gates and flooding with water, and then standoff between the farmers and the federal government. Basically, things are not looking real pretty down there right now. Basically, scientists are expecting a water temperature increase, of almost 12 degrees Fahrenheit by the summer of 2075 because of the climate changing. Already in 2002, the fish died because of the loss of water. Basically, hot water kills fish. About 75,000 salmon died in 2002. And scientists say there is a real trouble ahead, both for farmers and crops and wildlife and fish and people are all affected by the change in climate in the Klamath River Basin. Let's come closer to home for a minute. Let's look at the Willamette Valley and let's look at what climate scientists are saying they expect to have happen in this part of the world. Models that have been developed agree that annual average temperatures in the Willamette Valley will rise 6 to 8 degrees Fahrenheit by 2080. So what that says is that basically it won't really be at all unusual to have a 94 degree day in the middle of May as we had in 2008. Basically, intense weather events in the Willamette, such as flooding, will put developed properties at risk. And if no action is taken to prepare for the likely climate change impacts, damages could amount to millions of dollars, including road, air, and rail transportation. And there will be consequences for human health with degraded air quality, potentially raising the rates of asthma and other respiratory problems of all of our population. And the report recommends the establishment of cooling centers to reduce health consequences during extreme high heat events, particularly for those most vulnerable, including the elderly and the infirm. Now, how many people here like a good Oregon Pinot Noir? I love it. It's an inspirational wine. And scientists say that changed growing conditions are going to foster a shift in crops, orchards, and vineyards. One adaptation we can see in Oregon is the switch from growing the magnificent Pinot Noir grape to growing a less developed grape like the Syrah. Now, Syrah's okay, but it sure ain't a Pinot. So that's what we get to look forward to. So the reality is that we're seeing climate change impacts all over the world, and we're seeing some very specific climate change impacts right here in Oregon. 14 of the 15 hottest years on record have occurred in this century. 14 of the 15. And the hottest year on record ever measured was 2015. At this time this slide was produced, we had they'd done an analysis of the numbers to say that appeared to be true, 97% probability that 2015 is the hottest year on record. I get now that 2015 is, scientists are now saying it was the hottest year on record. So pretty remarkable. So we know that we've got a problem. We know we have to change. We know we can't just bury our heads in the sand and say, oh, nothing's going to happen. Because it's happening, and it's happening all around us, both around the world and here in Oregon. One of the things that is happening is that people are really starting to go, coal. Essentially, those are coal plants all over the country that were proposed and defeated. This is existing coal plants that were retired. This is coal plants that are going to be retired, including Boardman in Oregon, including Centralia in Washington. And so the people in this state and country are really going to say, let's stop going in that direction. So that's good news. And then we had this marvelous, incredible gathering of world leaders in Paris. It was known as COP21, and it was the UN climate conference that basically really acknowledged the significant problem that we were having with the changing climate. It was an incredible gathering, 186 nations all coming together, recognizing the need to act on climate change, supporting less carbon and more renewable energy. And I gotta say, it was really touch and go for a couple of weeks there as to whether they were gonna come to a good place. It was touch and go. But our president outlined his major climate actions, including the Clean Power Plan that requires coal plants to cut carbon emissions by over 30% by 2030. And Al Gore called Obama's carbon plan the most significant single action the United States has taken to address climate change. And 180 countries representing 98% of global emissions officially put forward national climate plans, and a process was established to review and potentially strengthen those plans every 5 years. So Paris really was a huge and inspiring success. So, I like this picture of the Eiffel Tower. It inspires me. And it really, it's still sinking in. For the first time, we have a global climate agreement. For the first time, we have a global climate agreement. For the first time, 186 nations have all made commitments to reducing emissions, and critically, we have a system in place to review these commitments and strengthen them in the years ahead. As a result of this Paris conference, we in fact have a common goal and a way to reach it. You can criticize the agreement, you can say, oh, it doesn't have enough strength and enough bite. But the reality is, when the whole world gets together and says, this is a problem and we recognize we need to do something about it, I think we should celebrate that has been in fact been achieved. There's a lot of work still to do, but we've got a good landmark put in place. And we, in this area, have the solutions very much at hand, whether it be getting energy from wind like we do in Sherman County, Oregon, and we do in Wyoming, and we do in Montana, or whether it be a real focus on solar energy. The U.S. government gave approval to the largest solar plant that's being located in the Mojave Desert and will provide power to over 140,000 homes. And this is that part of the Mojave Desert. You can see three towers going up, and surrounding each of those towers, a whole lot of solar reflectors that are going to put sunlight on those towers, and it's going to heat those towers to 1,000 degrees. And they're going to use that heat to create, guess what? Steam. And guess what they're going to use the steam for? They're going to use the steam to produce electricity, but it's all power from the sun. Solar energy is a big deal here in this state. Solar World decided to locate in Hillsboro in a former high-tech plant in, I think it was 2006. They're employing about 1,400 people producing solar panels in Oregon, big part of our economy. And basically, the reality is there's enough solar energy that reaches the Earth every hour to meet the power needs of the entire world for a year. So it's really clearly something we need to fully make use of. And it's very exciting because Deutsche Bank has said that we really think the trend is clear, that solar penetration rates are set to ramp worldwide. And it's kind of like we've reached that point. It's kind of like between 32 degrees and 33 degrees, fairly significant change takes place. 32 degrees you have ice, and 33 degrees you have water. We really have a shift going on right now that's very exciting and gives all of us, I think, some real hope. And let's look at the investment of dollars in new generating capacity. The gray line is fossil fuels, the green line is renewables. That's in 2009, renewables and fossil fuels were about equal. In 2013, renewables were about double fossil fuels. In 2014, they really outstripped the fossil fuels, and it's pretty remarkable. It's very inspiring. And this is what people are looking at in terms of new energy capacity coming from both fossil fuels on the left and renewables, hydro, nuclear, solar, wind, biomass, and geothermal on the right. And basically, that's 2015, and that's projection for 2020, and that's a projection for 2025, and that's a projection for 2030. Basically, people are looking at what's going on in the market, and they're saying, oh boy, there's a whole lot of focus going on renewable resources and really getting those developed. Citi says the age of renewables is beginning. They said that in 2014. You see that all over the world. This is in Africa. Essentially, the pay-as-you-go solar systems have very low initial costs and make these solar systems affordable for many Africans to put on their straw huts. Same thing you see in Bangladesh. Solar panels going on a house in Bangladesh, and they're installing these solar photovoltaic systems at the rate of 2 per minute in Bangladesh. In Pakistan, they've installed one of the world's largest solar facilities. So kind of think about this. Plant covers about 200 hectares. And will generate 300 megawatts of electricity by the end of this last year. IKEA store in Miami, Florida installed a 4,600 panel solar installation. So basically, we really are at a tipping point where solar is becoming the least cost option. And that's a quote from Tom Hutton, who's the president and CEO of American Capital Energy, it's very clear. Australia, more than a million residential properties in Australia have now installed solar systems, basically one in every seven households. Germany generates 78% of its electricity now from renewable resources. And let's look at what's happened in Chile. This is how much solar they had produced, 11 megawatts of solar at the end of 2013. At the end of 2014, 402 megawatts being produced in Chile. And this is a large 100 megawatt solar farm in Chile that's really the largest in South and Latin America. Costa Rica gets 100% of its electricity from renewable sources. And they did that for 100 straight days in 2015. And yes, even the ancient Vatican is getting a huge amount of its energy, thank you, Pope Francis, is getting a huge amount of its energy from these installed solar panels. Hawaii. You know, I've been to Hawaii a number of times, and I was really struck when I was first there at how much energy they got from burning fuel oil. And it always seemed a little weird to me, given how much sunshine and how much wind they have in Hawaii. Well, that's changed now. The Hawaiian legislature has adopted a law requiring 100% of its electricity to come from renewable sources by 2045. So they're not going to be dependent on Texas oil anymore. They're going to use the wind and the sun. Let's talk about where we are right now. We all live in homes, and this is a photo of a home that the redder it is, it shows the heat that's being lost by the home. And so in classic home, it loses a lot of heat out of the roof and out of the side walls. So there are things you can do, like double glazing your glass and installing insulation in your house to basically make your house much more energy efficient and not require so much energy. There are things you can do in terms of what you buy or what you use, whether it be televisions or water heaters or lamps or shower heads. All those things are available to you in a way that uses nowhere near as much energies in the past, and it's really a big and growing part of our economy. As you look at all the companies in Oregon that are starting to really focus on developing renewable energy and installing, helping homeowners install those uses to reduce their energy, it's all a big part of the economy. And I think it's an incredible source of new jobs for this region. Climate Solutions estimates that by 2028 in Oregon and Washington, solar energy will produce 22,000 new jobs. Wind energy will produce 6,000. Smart grid will produce 7,000. I mean, you can see the list. All of those things are things we need to do to reduce our carbon impact, and they improve our job. So, you know, it's kind of like, why are we doing this? I mean, we know that there's this incredible cost from continuing to live the way we've been living and burning fossil fuels. And that's a really good short list of the costs of carbon. So we need to put a price on carbon in the marketplace, and we need to put a price on denial in politics. And I have to say that I'm very excited to see that there's some very exciting efforts going on in the Oregon legislature. Oregon legislature has a 1 month short session this year, starting in February. There's a proposal that actually it did very well, a similar proposal did very well last session, and this proposal may in fact pass. And this healthy climate bill requires our Environmental Quality Commission to adopt an effective cap on carbon pollution, and it will utilize the market-based programs to help meet that cap. Basically, it's the old concept that polluter pays, and it generates payments for local jobs, rural areas, and clean air. So that's the Oregon Healthy Climate Bill that will be considered in the next session of the legislature. There's also a proposal that I didn't include in this slideshow. There's also a proposal that's coming in, basically that's agreed 50% so that it requires utilities to provide 50% of their electricity from renewable sources, not including large dams on the Columbia River. So it's really some very, very significant and exciting things happening. So the real question is, can we mobilize? And I would say that we clearly are mobilizing in Oregon. If you look at what's being proposed in the next session of the Oregon legislature, I'd encourage you to reach out to the legislators you know and make sure they know that you support good climate action and good policies on carbon. But the reality is, this country has an amazing history of being able to rise to the occasion, whether it be the We Can Do It, Rosie the Riveter in World War II, or whether it be Reverend Martin Luther King in the 1960s calling for equal rights, or whether it be John F. Kennedy saying, we're going to put a man on the moon in 10 years, and this country did it in 9. It's incredible the things we've been able to achieve when we put our minds to it, and this is what's at stake. This is our home. This is our planet Earth, and we know that. We know that this is the one planet. This is the only Earth we're ever going to have, or love, or touch, or tend, for our children, or for our grandchildren. And speaking of grandchildren, this is my grandson, Pippin, and this is my granddaughter, Cleo. And I can assure you that Pippin and Cleo would really appreciate it if all of us do everything we can to keep the climate a nice place to be living in, because they'd like to grow up and be farmers here in the state of Oregon. So it's our planet, it's our challenge, but I'm convinced that this state is moving in a really positive direction, and we can be an inspiration to a lot of other people in this country and around the world. So thank you very much.
Bill, thank you so much. This was educational and fun and just a very fine evening. I think Lynn has a first question for you, and we have time for just a few questions. If you've written them down and can pass them to the center aisle, I think Brett and Michelle will come and pick them up.
Bill, thank you. It's a sobering look at what's ahead, but if change is coming, we're the ones that have to do it. Well, I think there's a lot of curiosity about the seventh draft power plan that's just out. Can you give us some highlights from that?
Sure. What's really incredible, every 5 years, the Northwest Power and Conservation Council develops a plan for meeting the energy needs of the Northwest for the next 20 years. You do that every 5 years. So the seventh plan will be the plan that really gives direction, particularly to Bonneville, but also to other utilities. Other utilities use the plan for the next 5-10 years. That plan says that we can meet our expected energy growth in the next 5 years through primarily making use of conservation in the Northwest. We've seen the incredible development of a reduced demand for electricity because of conservation by residential industrial customers. And essentially the seventh plan says we don't need to build any new plants in the next, in the next 20 years, because we can meet the expected increase in demand through conservation and energy efficiency. And that to me is, I'm very proud to be part of that, and I'm very proud to be calling for that, as a good way to go toward the future.
Can you tell us what that energy conservation will look like? How will that unfold for Oregon?
Well, I think everybody here is familiar with energy conservation that individuals can do in their own homes. I think, you know, I'm certainly familiar with it in terms of making sure that your home is as energy efficient as possible, driving an energy efficient or electric car, all those kind of things that are very popular in this city. Are the kinds of things that really we look at in terms of projecting increased demand and increased resources needed to meet that demand. And essentially, the seventh power plan says that in 98% of the cases, we can meet our energy growth over the next 20 years by being efficient in our use of energy and through conservation. Industries have a real interest in energy efficiency because guess what? Every kilowatt they use costs them money, just like it costs us money. But industry sees it as a very direct part of their calculation of how do they keep their business profitable, is basically the less energy you can use to keep producing your product, the better off you're going to be. So there's a huge amount of interest in terms of energy efficiency and conservation in the commercial sector, and we're seeing great success in the homeowner sector as well. So that's really the future for now.
Speaking of the homeowner sector, this is an urban planning question. How can smart, dense infill development be encouraged to reduce transportation carbon emissions?
Well, I think the city of Portland, I don't live in the city of Portland, but my impression is that the city of Portland has really adopted policies to basically try to increase density and reduce sprawl. Now, that always leads to some controversy. Because when you're increasing density, people will say, well, I don't want to live next to a 10-story apartment building full of people. I want this to be a nice residential neighborhood, right? Well, density and making use of the urban area requires that you do things like, you know, 10-story apartment buildings for some people. I mean, it's part of the deal. But there's people that don't want that, but they want, you know, they want things more dense, but not near them. Now, that's the problem. That ain't going to work. But, you know, I think my impression is that the city of Portland is pretty committed in their land use plan to increase density and making sure that they're using urban spaces to the, you know, not to the maximum extent possible, but to a significant extent. And that, I think, can really help the climate with, you create neighborhoods where people can walk to the store and they can walk to their entertainment and they can walk instead of always being dependent on everybody getting in the car every morning.
Is there hope for our salmon? What kinds of mitigating things can we do to cool our rising temperatures? And will we have a future with salmon?
I really feel like there's real hope for salmon. Basically, one of the things we've learned is that one of the things you need to try to make use of as the climate warms, you need to make use of places in the river where cooler water collects and doesn't flow through and get mixed with the warmer water. So that basically, we were just talking about it today at the Power Council, was areas on the Willamette River where there are sections where it's a lot colder I mean, just the water in that part of the, not in the main river, because the main river is pretty well mixed, but side channels and all where there's really colder water, that's gonna keep salmon surviving for a while. It's like, I wish I could say, oh, well, it'll just be fine, but I can't, because if we continue to have, if the globe doesn't really deal with carbon pollution, salmon are gonna be cooked. It's just how soon and how when, but that's sort of the reality, is they can't really survive. They're a cold water fish, and we're not gonna have enough cold water for them. So there's hope, we can do it, but we really gotta act on it quickly.
Someone wants to know about the potential for plants to sequester carbon. And the question is, having heard about carbon farming and agroforestry as carbon sink, in order to store more carbon in plant matter in the soil, what can be done to encourage that? Is there some legislation or something else that we could do to encourage that in Oregon?
Well, I don't know. I used to be a legislator, and I would think about how to encourage this or how to encourage that. I don't know. I'm sure there are things that can be done. Oregon is very friendly to the agricultural community. If you have farmland, you pay farm use taxes, exclusive farm use taxes on your land, which makes it possible for you to really continue to farm and continue to grow. I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I don't have any specific answer to what we can do to encourage certain kinds of farming. It seems to me that the market is going to encourage some of that by the way it works.
Thank you. With the TPP, how can we affect change locally without having the TPP trumpet trump local, state, and national choices?
TPP.
Trans-Pacific Partnership.
Trans-Pacific Trade Partnership.
Oh, okay. I don't really have an answer to that.
Yeah.
I don't know. That's a good question. There are various proposals made for, freer trade around the world. TPP is certainly one of them. I'm blissfully not in the public sector anymore, where I have to really try to figure those things out. So I'm happy to say, I don't know.
One last quickie, and then we'll go to our sponsoring organizations.
Great.
Someone wants to know if they can get a copy of your presentation somewhere.
Well, I can't. I can give you copies of part of my presentation. I can't give you copies of the part of the presentation that has originated from Al Gore. I can give you all the stuff about ocean dead zone, oysters, rogue, Klamath, Willamette, and the last section. Spacing out what it was, but the last section that I just developed on the U.S. the whole climate treaty. I can give you all that. I can't give you the stuff that I got from the climate project, Al Gore's project, but I certainly can share the stuff that's from my production.
I will say we do have a community partner here tonight taking this presentation, and we'll be in conversation with you, Bill, possibly on being able to show it at a future time.
Yes,
for people.
We talked about that. Yeah. That should not be a problem. So.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Use that on planning future events. Right now, it's very
answer very briefly from representatives of our sponsoring organizations. So first is going to be Michelle and Brett speaking on behalf of Renew Oregon and the Oregon Environmental Council.
Thank you guys for sticking around. First, I want to thank 58th Avenue Resilience for inviting me to represent Oregon Environmental Council, or OEC for short, at this lovely event tonight. When I think about the special places in Oregon that I want to protect, this particular part of Portland is very near and dear to me. My husband's grandparents went to Vestal Elementary on the other side of Mount Tabor, and my husband and I were married on the top of Mount Tabor in 2010, and it just feels like home. So thank you so much for allowing me to be here tonight.